stops.
It feels like it's been, oh, a week. By the way, can I say something?
Yes.
Martha S. is here. Martha S. Now, when we started the show, Martha S., she used to call in, Skype in, tweet in.
Enthusiasm that we love.
That's true. Now, Martha, where'd you come here from?
Oh, I live in Berkeley, Northern California.
And you came here just for the show?
A schlep?
Just for you, too.
Oh, you did not. Did you really?
Not even Disneyland or Knott's Berry Farm?
Extra applause for Martha S.
Wow.
Wow.
Gosh.
Better make this a good show.
With love.
For a change. Okay, yeah. So I am Mark Kaiser. You are?
Wade Major.
Now, Wade and I are members of the LA Film Critics Association, and I say that every week because it's our only claim to legitimacy, really,
kind of,
is what it is.
Yeah.
Now, I have to say, I was thinking of actually getting you thrown out of the LA Film Critics Association because you fell asleep at The Last Airbender, which I called you on last week.
Yes.
And by the way, that film did very well. No to you.
We'll see how it does this weekend.
That's true. The eight-year-olds love it.
Do they really?
They do.
They should, they're a disgrace to their age.
To their parents. Okay. Exactly. Now, Wade and I also have a podcast.
Yes, we do.
The Digigods podcast, which
IGN
is all about
Digigods.
DVDs, which is IGN.com. Check us out. Or go to Digigods.com.
Yep.
But tonight, we're here to talk about movies.
Well, one movie.
One movie. Well, but also, we have a very special, now, producer Mike, I'm on it. I got it written down.
All right. I was going to say,
Curt Smith from Tears for Fears is here. Look at this. Now, he has an amazing announcement. And by the way, can I say something? When I look at Curt Smith, here's what I think of. Rock royalty.
I know.
Rock royalty.
Right? Totally.
Tears for Fears, solo work on my iPod right now, one of the very first bands, one of the very first, when I sold all of my DVDs, right, to fund my iPod.
Yeah.
One of the first bands, right there.
Yeah.
That I downloaded legally. Possibly.
Possibly.
Just kidding. Tears for Fears. Because we love Tears for Fears. So Kurt's going to be on a little bit later with a very, very special announcement. And by the way, we have another guest, Wade.
Two guests?
We have two guests. We have the musical guest, Curt Smith, right? Tears for Fears. The comedy guest, David Gruber Allen, is here later. Now, David Gruber Allen.
Did we drive Larry King off the air?
We are that good.
Really? Is this? Because it's like we're stealing the guests.
We are.
It's amazing.
David Gruber Allen, Freaks and Geeks, King of the Hill. LA comedy stage icon. He'll be here later to talk about his
awesome.
Celebrity Try This at Home pick. So there you go. We got a big show.
Wait, the more guests,
my parents
the less
are here
of us.
Too.
Oh, wow, Mike's, producer Mike's parents.
It's my dad's birthday tomorrow.
Oh, happy birthday. Well done.
Everybody's visiting.
What a show.
And he's visiting.
No, everybody's visiting. Everybody's
visiting.
Like the crazy,
amazing show.
Actually, I thought the audience
would
here.
We really should need to start charging, right?
You
for
know what?
Admission?
You know what? We can finally make some money off this goddamn show. Okay, let's start charging. All right, so we got a big show. Curt Smith is here. Dave Gruber Allen is here. Let's do This Weekend in Movies. Come on!
A long intro.
All right, it's a big, big week. And I don't just mean Big Mama's House 2 is finally on DVD. I don't mean that. It's a bigger movie we got to talk about, Wade. What is that movie?
That movie is Inception. Inception is the latest film from Christopher Nolan. It is his follow-up film to the Dark Knight, which, of course, became the second all-time highest-grossing film at the time it was released. Phenomenal success. Christopher Nolan is one of the hottest directors in Hollywood, one of the few who can sort of be an auteur and a commercial filmmaker all at the same time. Inception has been creating buzz for months and months and months. First with a trailer and a teaser that didn't really give you a sense of what it was all about. Then it kind of started to reveal its plot. The buzz got even stronger. We have a trailer?
Teaser? We got a clip.
Got a clip?
Even better.
Let's see it.
You create the world of the dream. We bring the subject into that dream, and they fill it with their subconscious.
How could I ever acquire enough detail to make them think that it's reality?
Well, dreams, they feel real while we're in them, right? It's only when we wake up that we realize something is actually strange. Let me ask you a question. You never really remember the beginning of a dream, do you? You always wind up right in the middle of what's going on.
I guess, yeah.
So how did we end up here?
Well, we just came from the,
Think about it, Ariadne. How did you get here? Where are you right now?
We're dreaming.
You're actually in the middle of the workshop right now, sleeping. This is your first lesson in shared dreaming. Let's get going.
the plot basically centers around, that's Leonardo DiCaprio there with Ellen Page. Leonardo DiCaprio plays a guy who's basically an expert at infiltrating people's minds, going into their dreams, and extracting information as part of industrial espionage. He's basically a guy who performs heists of the mind. These are like bank heists or building heists, like what you would see in Mission Impossible or even in like an Ocean's 11 film. And here he goes into dreams, sometimes dreams inside of dreams, inside of other dreams. And there's one case in particular that asks him to perform an inception, which is the opposite of an extraction. Don't take an idea out, plant an idea in. Apparently much more dangerous, much more all-encompassing, much riskier. But what keeps foiling all of these efforts is the fact that his deceased wife, who is part of his mental furniture, keeps inadvertently coming into these dreams, and he can't control her, and she's like the wild card that always throws everything out of balance. So that's the big issue here. There's this heist action, and then there's what is the ex-wife, played by Marion Cotillard, going to do when she shows up? What crazy things is she going to do? We saw this at the same screening last night. We have not talked about it since.
And you know what? Normally what I would do is I would talk to Wade after the screening, or I would email Wade, and hey, what'd you think?
No.
Didn't talk to him.
Because I wanted this to be fresh.
No.
It's our only movie today.
I think you didn't talk to me because you didn't like it.
You think so?
Please tell us, Wade.
Explain. Explain. I've intro'd the film.
Because you hate everything. That's why you're a critic.
I liked Predators last week, of all things.
I know, so did I. It was good.
Come on.
I admit it. I'm not a hater like you.
So
what?
Go. Let's hear what you thought. Let's hear what you thought.
What I thought?
Yeah.
I liked it a lot.
And
did you? Okay, I can tell by that reaction that I'm right. He didn't like it. So before you hear from me, the lover, hear from Wade, the hater. Go.
Okay, here are my issues. I don't think it's a bad film. I don't think it's a bad film, but I also don't think it's a good film. I think it's a problem film. I admire Christopher Nolan's ambition enormously. It is incredibly ambitious film. It wants to wrap itself around enormous ideas and concepts and a plot that has mechanics that are very, very, very difficult. I mean, it takes a half an hour to explain the rules. And even then, I was kind of getting a little bit upset. I was like, you know what, there are far too many rules and ladders for me to have to put together just to sort of make sense of this film. I don't want to have to build the script in my head while I'm watching it. But then I got into it, and I was able to kind of make sense of it. But the problem for me is that while there's a lot of virtuoso filmmaking in here, I don't think there's a lot of virtuoso storytelling. I think the movie gets in its own way too much. I think the mechanics are so convoluted, and the plot is so dense, that it's impossible to separate out the heist fact, the heist facet of the film from that story facet, from the relationship stuff with Marion Cotillard, which you're supposed to really feel for. You're supposed to believe that these people have this marriage, this incredible love, and there's this distress, and he's lost her, and the grief is what keeps interfering with the job. And I never cared. I just didn't care.
I'll say what fell short for me, although I liked it enormously anyway. Christopher Nolan has a knock on him that he's a very cold filmmaker. And if you look at his movies like Following, which I loved, and Memento, and the Batman films, and there's Prestige in there too, and Insomnia, these are not romantic films. So obviously he's not a romantic filmmaker. So here you have a movie that is just chock-a-block with, as you say, process and mechanics and a world that has to be figured out. What he tries to do, and doesn't really do it all that well, he tries to introduce two separate emotional strands. One is DiCaprio and his ex-wife issues, and the other is the Mark, the person who is being planted with this thought, played by Cillian Murphy.
Yeah.
He's got father issues. So between the father issues of the Mark and the ex-wife issues of the hero, he's trying to sort of put some sort of emotional component in
but
a film.
Did you care about either of them?
No, I didn't.
I didn't either.
But that's a
failing. That's a huge failing.
It's a failing. But I was okay with it because I like the fact that it's the type of story that you've got to pay attention. Nolan is always one or two steps ahead of you, but he's never totally pulling away. You've got to pay attention, but yet you can still stay in the game and you have a feeling, and you know what, and I don't say this a lot, I will see it again and pay for it because I feel like I need to see it again because there's a lot I didn't get, but I'm okay with that.
Here are some other problems. Anytime you have these movies where things take place in dreams, where anything is possible and you have to somehow corral it with these artificial rules about what you can and can't do, you inevitably create plot holes, huge plot holes, because the rules obviously aren't going to always make sense. And like at one point, Tom Hardy says, you know, you have to think, get a bigger gun, dear, think bigger ammunition, dear, whatever, and pulls out the big ammunition. Well, wait a minute. If someone has militarized their brain, as is the reference in the film, wouldn't you militarize it with tanks, with nuclear weapons, with something that'll just clean up the stuff immediately? I mean, are you really going to militarize your brain with guys with pistols and M16s? No, you're not. And the guys who go in there, I mean, is this really... I mean, I have the same problem with The Matrix. There are all these mechanics in The Matrix that don't make sense given what they claim is and isn't possible. So all these dream movies always kind of run afoul of themselves and their own rules, and you start asking yourself these questions that are impossible to answer and impossible to get a satisfactory answer for. Dreamscape, obviously, is a movie that comes to mind from the 80s, 1984, Dennis Quaid. Similar kind of a plot. I thought actually, as cheesy and schlocky as it was, executed the idea better. Not as good a movie, but executed the idea better. Brazil plays with these ideas a little bit. Open Your Eyes, Alejandro Amenábar's movie that was completely mutilated into Vanilla Sky here. Much better film.
I do like those films, but I also like this film because... Yeah. But to speak to your point about the world that they create, in the film, Ellen Page from Juno plays the architect, who's the person who actually builds the world in which all these other characters inhabit. And Ellen Page has a thankless job in the film, which is to explain the rules. She's essentially the audience surrogate.
Yeah.
She's the one who understands nothing like we do as the audience, and then DiCaprio sort of says it to her, and of course, he's really saying it to us. So yes, there's a lot to absorb, but...
She's great, by the way. I mean, I thought Ellen Page was just about the best thing in the movie. And I should say, too, before you go on, I just can't get into DiCaprio as an actor.
I like him. You know what?
I just can't.
I'll tell you something. I'll tell you something. And I'm really hot and cold on him because the knock on him is that he's got the baby face and no one can take him seriously as an adult actor. But when he was in Blood Diamond, that was the first time in Blood Diamond where I thought he's finally becoming that lead... He was nominated for an Oscar for it. He was finally becoming a man. miscast in The Aviator.
You have met people from South Africa, haven't you? They don't talk like that.
Well, whatever.
It's a terrible accent. It's horrible.
Don't worry about that.
Leonardo DiCaprio has one reaction when things get tough. It's this.
But here's a case where...
That's his intense look.
No, but here's a case where his boyish face, what's left of it, because he's getting older now, where his boyish face helps because you have to feel this guy's pain as he can't get over his wife. So if it was a total stone-faced Gary Cooper type, you'd really feel nothing in the movie.
You know, it just didn't work. If you had somebody like a Daniel Craig in that part, it would have worked for me. If you'd have had somebody...
Yeah, because that would be a James Bond film.
If you'd had somebody like a Clive Owen in the part, it would have worked for me. I mean, these are actors who know how to communicate toughness and vulnerability.
Clive Owen
he
would
can't
be good.
Communicate either.
Clive Owen would be
Clive
good.
Owen would have been amazing.
Yeah.
But he can't. I don't think Leo can communicate either. Every time he's in a part where he's required to do any kind of heavy emotional lifting, he just fails for me.
He fails for me.
Absolutely.
Now, the one thing we'll say is that before we move on is that the film looks amazing. It is extremely...
Wally Pfister shot it.
Wally Pfister shot it.
You know, a great, extraordinary cinematographer.
He also shot the two Batman films. Yeah. It's very sort of modern and cool and a little desaturated.
Although, honestly, our good friend Tim Cogshell emailed me afterwards. He said, you know, all the look of the film was pretty much done already in Dark City. And he's right. Dark City did a lot of this
already.
I
love Dark. That's a great movie. Yeah. Dark City, everyone.
So, you know, I mean, we can go on and on and on with all these dream movies and these, you know, is it or isn't it real movies, but I don't see anything in this film that I haven't seen done better elsewhere from a story standpoint.
I'll say this. If he shoots for the stars and gets the moon, that's okay, especially this summer.
I'm more impressed with his ambition than with his execution. I agree with that. But that's a problem for me. If you're going to be really, really ambitious and you're not going to completely deliver, your ambition generates my expectations. And if you set your ambition really high, I'm setting my expectations high. And if you fail to deliver, then I don't get what I came for. And that's a problem.
So basically, the issue is the emotional component was not there for you.
Emotional component not there. And honestly, the whole heist factor, I mean, so it takes place in somebody's head. It's still a heist. It's still not as good as Ocean's 11. It's not as good as the first Mission Impossible.
But again, it's exciting, and you also have to keep up with it. And movies nowadays you never have to keep up with because, again, there's actually three layers.
Yeah.
And by the way, we have to call out the editor because it was very well edited. Because when you're...
Excellent.
When
excellent
you're not
editing.
Only... When you're not only dealing with three layers worth of reality, but also real life, It looks like a script problem, and of course it is, but it's also an editing problem because you got to keep all those straight, and the guy does a great job.
He does a great job, but again, the fact that it actually does that is what undercuts and derails the emotional component.
Well, he's just not an emotional filmmaker. It's like Stanley Kubrick.
Yeah,
I mean,
but
I don't want to compare
then
the
don't,
two.
Then, like don't, then don't put those threads in the movie. Don't lead me to believe that I'm going to be seeing an emotional movie.
Okay, hater, lover.
Don't put
I'm
it
just
there.
Saying it. You know? Proof
there
right
it
there.
Is.
There it is. All right, I say see it. In fact, I'm going to see it again.
You know, but here's my last analogy. My last analogy. Here's why I think you and a lot of others actually like this or think you like it more than you do. Imagine that you put 10-pound weights on your ankles and you walk around all day. When you take them off, you think you're going to fly, but you're not flying. You're just walking around like you would if you didn't have 10-pound weights on your ankles. We have seen so much junk this summer. There's been so much crap this summer, so much junk, that just the fact that there's a movie that's not junk, it suddenly feels like a masterpiece.
Yes, it does.
But it's not.
Yes.
Well, by comparison.
Thank you very much.
Things explode upon explosions. Like
there you go.
There it is.
That's all that matters.
So Inception, very highly recommended for me. Recommended for you, buddy. Just say it. Yes, we're moving on.
You know what? See Toy Story 3 again.
Oh, how dare you. All right, there you have it. That's Inception. So that's this weekend in the movies. The only really movie that counts this weekend. So now that we got that out of the way, let's do some news, Wade. What do you say?
News.
News. Chad?
Hey guys, how you doing?
How you doing there, Chad?
Welcome to my new command center.
Let's see it. There we go.
Whoa, hey, Chad.
Nice.
Yeah, I moved out of the dairy cooler and into an abandoned supply closet. I'm moving up in the world.
Is that a diploma?
It is. It's my certificate of achievement.
And that looks like your childhood home above your right shoulder.
I was there briefly.
Okay.
All right, what do you got for us?
I've got some news.
All right.
Here we go. Tom Cruise will indeed reprise his role in Mission Impossible 4, despite the lukewarm box office performance of his recent film, the lamely titled Night and Day. Yawn. Next. In other casting news, Mark Ruffalo has been offered the role of the Incredible Hulk in the Avengers movie. Negotiations haven't even started, so there's no telling whether he will accept the role yet, but he would replace previous Hulk, Edward Norton. Either wanted too much money or is too difficult to work with, depending on who you ask. Now there's a title for you. Previous Hulk. It has a nice ring to it, kind of like former Miss America. If only I could somehow earn the title Previous Hulk, I could die a happy man.
You know, it's just unbelievable.
Well, let's start with Tom Cruise. There was the thing about Tom Cruise where the wisdom for about a week was if Night and Day doesn't open well, Mission Impossible 4 would not happen.
Would not happen, yeah.
Now, Night and Day did okay.
Night and Day did okay, but Night and Day was also, it was not positioned terribly well in the summer. It didn't get as much advanced buzz as a lot of other movies. It was not heavily hyped, so.
It's also, but here's the thing, it's also a function of you have two stars who are a little bit older.
Yeah.
Tom Cruise and Cameron Diaz, okay, maybe in cosmic terms they're very young, but in terms of the average weekend moviegoer, they're a little bit older.
Yeah.
So it did okay, and it didn't really get the adults to see this sort of newfound charade. That being said, because it's kind of like charade.
It is, and it's a good movie.
It is a good movie.
I'm not a hater. I like that one.
Did you?
I did.
Let's give him a hand. Wade likes something. Yeah. Come on. Shut down the internet.
Now and again.
Yeah.
It's fun, right?
And I want to say something about how everyone says that they're too old and everything. All I hear is Cameron Diaz looks terrible. She's got a banging body for however old she is.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So just because women get older doesn't mean that they can't still be in movies.
Thank you.
By the way, can I say, I disagree.
Damn
right.
Mean that, Mark.
What?
Now we're getting a lot of hate mail. People are going to think you actually.
You know what? As long as you're watching, what do I care? Hate mail.
Okay.
Jesus Christ.
Now, as to Mark Ruffalo, honestly, this is what I find so funny about the whole Hulk thing, because he turns into other actors more than he turns into the Hulk, right?
He really does.
This is incredible. This is our third actor in three films. Wouldn't you think, and they're saying, oh, well, you know, Edward Norton's too hard to deal with, and, well, yeah, it goes without saying. But the problem here is that no one has actually become identified with the character of the Hulk the way that they have with some of the other characters that they're trying to brand in the Avengers. And it's because the Hulk is the least interesting of those because he's a CGI guy. No one cares about who he is when he's not CGI, and they barely care when he is CGI.
And he holds,
it's the weak link.
And he also spends half of the movie being the Hulk, where there's really no semblance of who he is as a civilian. Like with Iron Man, you still feel as if Tony Stark's in there.
Yeah.
When it's Spider-Man, you feel like it's his teenager who's got to get his life together. He's going to get beaten up. With the Hulk, he's just sort of this Hulk.
Yeah, and frankly, I liked Eric Bana. I don't know why Eric Bana is not in the running anymore. I mean, I thought he was a very, very capable Banner, but you know.
But Banner's he's yesterday's news. That's the problem.
I guess.
All right, Chad. What else you got for us?
Oh, Mel Gibson is at it again. As most people know, there have been several more recordings of a ranting and unhinged Mel Gibson that have surfaced, and they've proven once and for all that Mel is the mayor of Crazy Town and a city council member of Racism Village. The internet has gone crazy over these recordings, and several internet memes have cropped up as a result, such as the site that features Mel quotes over pictures of cute kittens. Aww. They're very cute in a disturbing way. As a reasonable and even-tempered person, I find little that is funny about this deranged jackass, except for the fact that his ridiculous over-the-top breathing is pretty funny. The way he huffs and puffs and pants and wheezes on those recordings, he just may be a distant relative of the Vader family. And that scares the crap out of me.
You know, I have to say something. Look, you've left messages on my machine very similar to those. You've called me some of those things. You know, in the heat of the moment, you say things
sometimes
that you don't mean.
Sometimes you just got to say what you say, you know?
Sometimes you say things in the heat of the moment, you don't really mean them.
No.
So he's losing it. These are not the rants of someone who is just angry. This is like medication time. This is putting you in a padded cell time. And Mel's always kind of been on the verge there. You know, in Lethal Weapon, when he goes kind of kooky, it feels a little too real.
Well, what'll be interesting is how will the rehabilitation tour begin?
Oprah?
Will he do The View? And will
it'll
he do
be,
Oprah?
No, it'll start with Oprah. It'll start with Oprah. That's awesome. I like that. It'll start with Oprah, right? It'll start with Oprah because there's a racial aspect to all of this that, you know, Oprah will be the doorway to coming back. It'll go on to Barbara Walters because you gotta shed a tear, right? And Larry King will probably be dead by then, so.
Well, he's gone. He quit the show.
Right, so, but even still, you know, even
he's
if.
Frank, he's dead now, Frank. Yeah! Hook him on Superfoo Movies.
Yeah, only if we
and
can.
Then, and then, and get this, I bet he'll do a new Lethal Weapon film, just so his first film out is something you know people will be excited about.
So he can hug Danny Glover. He can hug Danny
That's
Glover.
Right.
Woody Allen will guest star.
That's right. It's Lethal Weapon.
So he can hug. Well, you know, so he can show that he loves Jews too.
Oh my goodness.
You know.
All right, Chad. What do you got for us? One more story? Yeah, two, six more.
I do. Well, there's more news about the Overture Films collapse that we reported on last week. Now, bear with me. This is a long and complicated story, so I'll try to be brief. Chris Albrecht is a Starz executive. He goes on vacation to Spain because he's a rich, fancy man. He gets an email on his BlackBerry concerning the future of Chris McGurk and Danny Rosett, the two guys in charge of Overture Films, who apparently didn't know that it was going down. Chris Albrecht, giddy from suntan lotion and Spanish guitar music, responds, saying that they should be removed. But apparently he doesn't know how a BlackBerry works and attaches his response to an entirely different email, which then gets sent out to about 400 people, including the two guys in question. McGurk and Rosett get upset and quit. That's the story. Now, I called Chris Albrecht for a comment on this, and when he picked up the phone, all I heard was beeping and a muffled voice saying, "How does this confounded doohickey work?" And then he hung up on me. And then I received an email from him with his social security number and bank account information. Chris Albrecht needs to go to BlackBerry school.
Wow.
That company is screwed.
That is so amazing. Like, that takes a major news story and just turns it into tabloid gold.
It really does.
That's just amazing.
And we had talked last week about how.
Was that the real email? That was it, right?
Yes.
Yeah, that was it.
For shizzle.
I don't report lies.
Yeah. All right. All right, I'll buy it.
Now, Overture still has three films to release.
Three films to release, and one of we brought this up last week because we were talking specifically about Let Me In, which is the one that everyone's kind of been hanging on because the trailer came out the exact same, almost the same week that this announcement hit. So, and all the buzz started going about the trailer for Let Me In, which is the remake, of course, of Let the Right One In. And we encouraged all of our viewers and our listeners to get out there and put a little juice behind the film and encourage Overture to not let this stifle the release of the film, because the issue was whether or not the film was going to get a proper release, because Albrecht wanted the didn't necessarily want to give the film the kind of release that it was that McGurk was asking for. And so we threw out, let's put that card up there again. Okay, we want everybody to email Adam Keen, that's at adam.keen, K-E-E-N, at overturefilms.net, put in the subject line, Let Me In, and say you want this film to get a proper release. You're a fan, you want this film to get out there just like a real movie, not a quickie release, not a limited release, not something that's just going to kind of prepare it for video, but something that really, really puts this movie in the marketplace. Because, I gotta say, I may actually have seen part of the film.
What?
Oh, part or maybe all of the film.
What?
I don't know. I can't really say, but, you know, better than the original.
What? Better than the original?
What?
Did you say it was...
I didn't say anything.
Oh,
I'm just saying maybe. Maybe. And that, by the way, completely unrelated to anything that we did here last week. It's just the weirdest coincidence. Honestly, truly, I'm not kidding. Total freaking coincidence. So, but yeah, get those emails out. Send those emails to Adam Keen and load it up. Let Overture know that there is real fan excitement for this film and that they should keep the company together and give it a shot. See what happens this fall. I think they've got that and the Philip Seymour Hoffman film.
That's right, Jacko's Boating, which is his directing debut.
I mean, this could be a really, really great fall for Overture, and it's unfortunate that there was this disruption in the executive ranks, because it could this could be the fall that really makes the company.
Because the thing is, you know, we talk a lot about little companies and sort of the machinations of the industry. And the thing is that when things like this happen, it seems really, really inside baseball, but if you trickle it down, it really does affect the movies that you see. And when
it does.
A lot of like Grown Ups doesn't have this problem.
No.
Grown Ups is just a piece of ass that's going to get made anyway.
But
if you want to see a good movie, it's tougher to get it out there, and that's why companies like this need to be saved.
And there's this perception that movies like this, like Let Me In, may not necessarily... Oh, come on, Chad. Get with it. That movies like this might be a little too sophisticated for certain audiences, and it's not. I mean, this is the kind of movie that if you're sick and tired of junk, if you're sick and tired of just dumb comedies and silly romances and brain-dead action films, and you want something that's got mood and style and a great story and real heart and emotion and really kind of pushes all your buttons, this is what you want to get out there. So encourage it. Help encourage not just these films, but more movies like them. And Overture is one of the few companies out there that was making movies like this. So let's, you know, whoever takes over, even without McGurk in charge, let somebody else get in there who knows that this is what audiences want and will keep this kind of an agenda going.
There you go. All right,
that's
Chad.
What we want.
Look at that impassioned plea for Wade Major.
Yes.
The hater, temporarily a lover. Yeah. All right, Chad, is that it?
Well, actually, I have a few more things I'd like to talk about. I'd like to talk about a few specials that we're running at Empire Market.
Oh, nice.
Well, I don't think we have time. But no, wait, we got two guests. Chad, we got two guests. We don't have time. You had your moment.
Oh.
Sorry, Chad. Moving on.
What?
I'm just saying, we got Curt Smith's here. Dave Gruber Allen's here.
What? After all I've done for you? You're both an embarrassment. An embarrassment! You have no souls! You should just freaking smile and listen to my in-store specials, because I deserve it!
But you know what? He still can't do that thing his brother does when he makes you choke. He can't do that.
No.
Telepathically choke.
No, that's true.
So you rot in that market, buddy. Not
send,
as good
send
as
Send me
brother.
The coupons. I'll take coupons.
So there you go. That's the news with Chad Vader. Come on, how good is that?
Yeah.
Well done, Chad Vader. Okay, so...
this
is horrifying. Okay. All right, so we talked about Inception.
Yes.
We've gotten the news out of the way. Now, Wade, we have two special guests. The first
we
one
do.
We want to bring on to talk about the celebrity try this at home.
Yes.
Now, the celebrity try this at home last week, which we talked about, was suggested by Dave Gruber Allen, who, if I turn my head about 30 degrees to the left, will be right here. Now, Dave Gruber Allen, he recommended the Bank Dick.
Oh, what a great recommendation.
Which is one of the
well
best
done.
Ever made. W.C. Fields.
So funny.
Now, Gruber, Freaks and Geeks, right?
Great show.
King of the Hill.
Great show.
Right? Goes all the way back to news radio.
Yeah.
Look, you
naked
go on.
Trucker.
Naked Trucker? Even, look, even the Gilmore Girls. He was even on the Gilmore Girls, is that not right? Three times.
We're in the aura of a legend.
Exactly. In fact, let's take a look right now at a clip of Gruber's work.
There's two ways you can look at anything in this life. Take my job, for instance. I could get up every morning and go, oh, I don't want to go and help a bunch of kids. I'm tired. But I don't. I get up and put on my shirt and my tie, and I say, hot dog, let me at him.
Do you actually say the words hot dog?
Yes, I do. I know you're struggling. That's what they made guidance counselors for, to help you. I understand you've just been through puberty. You guys are tall. I'm surprised you fit through that door, quite frankly, okay? A lot of times you might see, maybe you're taking a shower or something, and you go, what are these? What's that? But you feel alone and confused, and you don't think anyone understands. Well, I do. Lots of people do. Even Mr. Alice Cooper. Bet you don't think he's a square, do you?
No, man, Alice Cooper rocks.
Do you know this song? Lines form on my face and hands. Lines form from the ups and downs. I'm in the middle without any plans. I'm a boy or girl, and I'm a man or woman. I'm 18, I get confused every day. 18, I just don't know what to say. 18, I gotta get away. Come on, Nick, fill in those drums there, will ya? Oh, yeah. You guys know what I'm talking about? Is this making any sense at all? I think it is.
You will. I think you will. Hey, good round! Welcome to the show.
You know, Freaks and Geeks was our life. Our high school experience was Freaks and Geeks.
I was a freak and a geek, actually.
Yeah. I both.
Basically
we
was
both.
A dateless wonder. No,
I was. You know, we had the science fiction freaks and the DVD and the D&D geeks.
Right.
And or was the no? Was the science sci-fi geeks and the either way. You know, different camps. Mm-hmm. I was in one, not the other.
So how'd you wind up on the show?
I wound up by being one of the few, or maybe the only person to audition for that part.
That's a great story, I gotta tell you. The story of triumph over tragedy.
I will
right
say
there.
This, I auditioned for the part. I don't know if anybody else did. Because it was Paul Feig said, hey, I got a part that you might be really good at, seeing as I worked in Glendale Middle Schools in the 80s when I first moved to LA, right? Yeah. Substitute teacher and a special ed teacher's aide. And so I was familiar with middle school and high school stuff at the time. And Paul goes, hey, you might be interested in this part in this show. He's kind of a hippie guy, kind of a weirdo.
Right.
And so I did audition. Just is that clear? Does Mark understand that?
Yeah,
that
yeah.
I actually did audition for the part.
I understand.
Oh, yeah. I didn't just walk in and put on my corduroy jacket and start playing guitar.
Now, I didn't realize that you were a teacher.
I was a substitute teacher, yes, and an education aide. I was never a certified teacher, and I think students in California can be glad that they never heard. Please welcome Mr. Allen to your class today in a teacherly role, because, you know.
Disaster.
Kids don't need that. They have a hard enough time as it is.
Exactly. Okay, now.
It's hard. Education is hard, all right? Let me put that out there.
And
both learning and teaching.
Is that is true. Now, but yeah. did you come out here, you didn't come out here to be a teacher, did
Here's what I did. I came with Dave and Steve Higgins, right? Higgins Boys and Gruber, to do funny stuff. And we did funny stuff at every single place except the Improv on Melrose and the Comedy Store, because they hated sketchy, oh, you guys are a three-person comedy group? No, thank you. So we played all these cool places, the Ice House in Pasadena, the Natural Fudge Company, actual place in the 80s, and played all these places looking for those opportunities. And Joel Hodgson was given a chance to produce a show for the new Comedy Channel, 1989, right? Now Comedy Central, right? And he said, well, there's these guys, I can't describe it. They do a sketch comedy, but they also live at a house in North Hollywood. And they sit around and drink coffee and smoke and goof around all day long. I'm thinking of putting those two together. And he did. And so we moved to New York. My first time on TV was with the Higgins Boys and Gruber on the original Comedy Channel.
Right.
Thanks in large part to Joel Hodgson. So.
And Joel Hodgson, of course.
Cinematic Titanic and formerly Mystery Science
Theater. Mystery Science Theater, my favorite show of all time.
No, there you go.
Give it up.
Sorry.
Now,
I like to make it easier. MST3K. They always credit me with, yeah, with saying that. I go, why don't you guys, nerds, just call it MST3K? And they go, oh, yeah, that's good. So yeah, that's
like
my one.
Like CE3K.
Exactly.
Close Encounters.
Ooh, Close Encounters. Yeah.
Right. Oh, that's a good one. I like that.
That's how I know it.
Like CK1. I don't have time to say Calvin Klein 1 cologne.
Right.
I'm a busy playboy out doing playboy things.
Whatever that might
CK1.
Be.
CK1.
Now, you know what I mean? Now, here's the thing. You in L.A., you're like a comedy, like, frickin' icon. You play all over town.
Listen, I was at Con. I'm going to disagree. Now I see what you have to go through all the time.
It's amazing,
like he's wrong most of the time.
I know.
Not an icon.
I'm being complimentary.
A presence. At a bus stop, usually. People see me all the time. It's like, hey, that is good. But Jon Stewart from the Daily Show nearly hit me on Sunset Boulevard. I'm waiting for a bus. I go, oh, there's my light. Jon Stewart. It's like, hey, Jon, how's it going?
That was a nice one. Did he invite you on the show?
He did not, or in his car. I did not get a ride or a place on his show. He's a nice man, though. I like the man.
Yeah, that's
so iconic. Thank you for that. The only time I was a big icon, bigger than the billboard, those crazy billboards that they add things to them, like, you know what I mean? The show they're pitching is so big that it doesn't even fit in a regular-sized billboard. Naked Trucker billboard.
Naked
right?
Trucker.
David Koechner. I'm just saying. And the group is a pretty tall guy. So it's David Koechner, some sort of truck, some sort of flag, and then Gruber over Santa Monica, over Hollywood Boulevard, going, I'm large and nude. Frightened yet? Tune in.
How does that feel when you...
Weird. Waiting for a bus under that one, I promise you. That was a weird one.
The first time you drove down the street and you saw the Naked Trucker
first
billboard...
First time I rode, I'm telling you the truth. The first time I rode in the bus down the street. That was me on the bus.
Don't ever give him a ride in your car.
Your car will be destroyed. Producer Mike's car was destroyed by me.
Yeah.
Another story for another show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now the
every time producer Mike hears the song Rain by the Beatles, he just starts crying. Because I destroyed his car in the rain. So, anyway. When the rain, because he's starting to ball.
There it is.
If it rains and Gruber's waiting at the bus stop, let him wait.
Now, you don't want to own a car? Or?
The cars are okay. There was an accident way back when that I wasn't even involved in. That's what became triggered. It's like, wait a minute, how can my car be totaled and taken from me when I wasn't even in it? But it was somehow. And then I realized, hey, you can actually get around this town. It takes a long time, and you read a lot of magazines, but you can.
I think you're the only one.
It takes a long time in a car, too.
It does, indeed, yeah.
Yeah, you can't win.
No, you can't. So my footprint is like this. Is my carbon footprint?
You are a no-impact man. Yeah. You are actually no-impact man.
Exactly.
I don't know if you saw the documentary about a guy who wants no carbon footprint, wants no garbage.
Negative impact.
You are a negative impact man.
Negative impact.
I have negative impact in show business and the environment. I'm just saying.
It's called
self-deprecating humor,
folks.
I
didn't want to say that. Okay, now let's talk about King of the Hill, because we all love
King of the Hill.
All right, come on, let's give it up for King of the Hill.
Come on.
Yeah. So you were the voice of?
Appleseed.
Yeah.
Nice. Which was a guy who looked a lot like me, because one thing I didn't know about the show is that they read it all, do you know this? They read it all together, usually. Mike Judge and some other voices will come from, Kathy and Jim, I think, was in Canada at the time, whatever. Voices will come, but there's a room at Fox, and it's like all these characters. Can I tell you another animation story in a minute? Okay. Because this, it's pretty, like Toby Huss was there and a lot of Stephen Root, all these characters, and they're there in the room with you. So you kind of read it like we are sitting in this room,
which
right?
Which is unusual, because animation, you typically read the sides independently and they edit it all together.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it's kind of cool. And so there's also people there drawing. And it's kind of weird.
That's
then
great.
They're going like, okay, long
Some
hair, tall
live?
Forehead,
they
super
draw
handsome.
Live as you do.
Like you could hear the guy going, that guy's really good looking. As he's drawing me. But then sure enough, when it comes out, I was like, wow, that does look kind of like me and not exactly like me.
That's
I got to tell
great.
You this one. I've only done one Scooby-Doo episode, but I went in as like, imagine this, counselor guy. Weird teacher guy or something. Yeah, exactly. It was, believe me, it was my toughest role yet. Down there was this, and I don't know the names. You got to tell me, the Scooby-Doo.
And Shaggy.
Shaggy. And Daphne.
And
we all want to sleep with Daphne.
They're all down there.
Who do you want to sleep with, Daphne? Was she a lesbian?
What? Who?
It just Scooby derailed the whole show.
It's Scooby.
Back to
Bill,
the story.
Yes. Yeah, thank you. Okay. Moving on. Go.
No, just saying this, that when you hear those voices, it is a hilarious thing. Because, like, here's this other guest star. Here's this other guy. And then you're... And it's like, oh, my God, that is Scooby-Doo. It's just a studio in North Hollywood.
Is that it?
The story was a lot more interesting until he interrupted
it. I know.
Oh, don't blame me.
And then the guy goes, and then the Shaggy guy, he was awesome too. He goes, hey, Scoob. It was really funny to hear these voices. Oh my God, it's that guy. And that other guy doing the dog. Anyway.
Oh, that's great. Right.
But now, but do you enjoy doing the voices? Because the voices you
I
show
like
up
doing funny voices because they're all like me anyway, you know?
So did you
Here's
like...
my old man voice. I'm an old man. See? Startlingly similar to me, which is a little twist.
What's your naked trucker voice? I forget.
That was an amalgam different. Of country guys. It's just kind of like this. Just clip it off. Same voice.
Yeah,
exactly. My Boston guy, I'll say, hey, it's Mike Vaughtman. Put a V next to the R.
All right.
Suddenly, hey, it's a vote of V. Hey, don't touch my brower. See, it's me, yeah. Basically.
Oh, oh, Gruber, wow.
See?
Yeah.
You thought I was Boston guy.
Great.
Anyway.
All right, so.
Gilmore Girls, though. Come on, right? Where's
Gilmore
my
Girls.
LGBT yeah. fan?
Let's do it.
Let's
Gilmore
go.
Girls, LGBT yeah. fan.
Now, that was really fun, though, because they had one troubadour, Grant Lee Phillips, who was the town troubadour, right? And so I got to be the second troubadour. That was my title. Because all my things, like I was Activist 3 on Arrested Development, Activist 3.
Yeah!
Right? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And Troubadour 2 on Gilmore Girls. But it was fun because Grant Lee Phillips was there doing this great music. And he was an actual troubadour. And then I was screwing the thing up. But I got to marry them. I was in the big Finnish thing, Marilyn Ryskop and Sparks and Sonic Youth. Were they in that one? So, you know, the big wrap up. It's the big, Martha's with me, she knows, right? Yeah, it was the big wrap up episode. It was like, oh my God, these are all super famous bands. You know, and you're Lauren Graham and the whole gang, so.
Nice. What's interesting before we get to the bank ticket is that like, as I hear you talk, I realize you're like a classic working actor.
I am that.
You know what I mean? It's like you're not some guy who's just like not working and pretending he's an actor. You work all the time.
You're not waiting tables. You're not in bread lines.
No.
You know.
No. In fact, the original group I was in Des Moines was called Don't Quit Your Day Job. That was our joke because we all had day jobs. Moved out here, had a day job in Glendale Schools, right? Until. Joel Hodgson comes along, Josh Weinstein also, right? Also with Cinema Titanic. They say, come to Minneapolis, make this thing. So it was like two roads, conversion of words, Robert Frost poem, right? And I go, oh, let's do this one. Go to New York for a TV show or go to Cal State LA and learn how to teach.
Awesome.
Right.
It was pretty easy
choice. And then the road converged, though, into this backtracking to all of us at Later with Greg Kinnear, with Kaiser, me, and Gruber working at Later with Greg Kinnear.
That's
all
right.
Together.
All
comes together.
We used to work on an NBC late night show called Later with Greg Kinnear.
Yep.
Which was on at 1:35 in the morning.
Yeah.
Now, do you remember, if I put you on the spot,
yeah.
Do you remember your favorite bit, so funny, but they rejected it and you got really pissed off?
Oh, gosh.
Because we used to.
There's a lot of funny filtering going on.
There's a lot of funny filtering.
We called it funny filter. Given something really good, it doesn't come out so good. It was called a funny filter in the writer's room.
I was one of the producers.
I'll give it away.
One of the producers, and Mike and Gruber, they were on the writing staff, and it was a comedy show. And the show
was a comedy show.
The show was funny, but there was a lot of funny stuff that came out of that room. You know?
Here's one of the funny things that did happen. Crosby, Stills, and Nash appeared and tried to sing.
Oh,
which
my
was probably
God.
The best comedy bit
I've always
that we
wanted
didn't write.
That tape. It was really, yeah.
Here's the thing.
And we all got called down there.
I'm
we all kind of snuck down there. Remember when they were singing it? The word got out and it was not pretty.
Well, we're going to retape that. We had a problem in the booth. It's like, no, we didn't. The problem was with three dudes singing their song. And my thing, I love those guys. Love them, love them, love them. But if your thing is you're known for harmony, you kind of have to do that.
Yeah.
Don't you?
Yeah.
It's like Devo's kind of known for super poppy, cool, you know.
Yeah.
We're not wearing the outfits anymore or doing kind of modern music.
Yeah.
Wow. You kind of have to. So it was it was weird, right, Producer Mike?
Yeah, yeah.
It was weird.
But you did play the one guy. It wasn't the guy under the stairs.
It was the guy under the desk, which was the tip of the hat.
Nothing at all like the Chris Elliott thing.
It was not at all like Chris Elliott's thing on Letterman at all. But it's fine. Larry King was mentioned earlier, right? Mm-hmm. One funny bit that did happen was his suspenders. Do you remember that one, Producer Mike? It's like, what do we know about Larry King? And we would get those little sheets, right, with he went to this school and he did this and that. He wore suspenders. Let's just do that. And he had crazy suspenders that went all around. Very slapsticky and hilarious.
Yeah.
And that one made it. So I don't know the answer to the other question, but I can say there's one. How about Larry King's suspenders get caught? you know, in John's, John the stage manager's.
That's right.
Something, and then, you know,
why don't you remember, why don't you remember me on Lady with Greg Kinnear in a wedding dress?
Oh my gosh.
I appeared, and I have this on DVD, by the way. I appeared on the show in a wedding dress.
I want to see that on YouTube.
Oh, burn that.
I do want to see that.
How do I not know about this?
That's going up on YouTube.
That's fine.
Yeah,
I got to find it. Pounds heavier.
You've denied me years of opportunities to humiliate you.
Exactly, I know. We did a bit where Greg was auditioning for a wife, right? So you probably wrote this bit.
I probably didn't write it. Go ahead.
Exactly, because it wasn't funny. You probably liked that. Absolutely nothing to do with it.
Auditioning for a wife.
So he was sitting in the back with the casting director,
right?
And these women would come up on stage and say in two lines or less why they thought they should be Greg's wife.
Right.
So a woman would come on and say, she was wearing a wedding dress, lifts up her veil, says, I should be Greg's wife because I'd make a great mother. Mm-hmm. And Greg says, next. Second girl comes on, lifts up the veil, says, I should be Greg's wife because I'm a great cook and I'd be a great provider. And then Greg says, oh, she's okay. Next. And then I walk
in
a wedding dress, comedies and threes. I come on and say something like, you know, because I would stalk you, whatever it is I said. Mm-hmm. But the whole bit was that it was a guy,
right,
and let's just say a fat guy at that point, coming on the show and in a wedding dress. And you know what? It was funny because I remember when the producers walked through the halls and said, we need a guy to dress in a wedding dress for a bit. And everybody said, no, why would I want to do that? When they came to me, I'm like, yes. Who wouldn't want to go on network TV in a wedding dress? I mean, how many opportunities do you get to do that?
Weird goals. You have very weird goals.
It really was one of my only goals in life.
You know what,
I want to graduate college.
Gruber, what are you up to now?
As you're saying that, though, as Mark's saying that, it made me think like of a Three Stooges bit. It had all the hilarity of that. But I love Three Stooges, where it's like, hey, these three super sexy ladies in the harem. Right, this comes down, I'm sexy, so I'm not sexy. It's like, she was sexy, it's just a teeth issue. Why are we turned off by this third harem lady? And that's, you know.
All right, but speaking of the Three Stooges.
He was way ahead of the Prop 8 curve, am I right?
Oh, totally.
Like, crazy,
yes.
That was 40 years ago.
Yeah, amazing, right?
Wow.
Speaking of the Three Stooges.
Love them,
You realize that Shemp Howard was in the bank dish.
Yeah, Mark, that's why I chose the film.
Come on. Why do I not get an applause for that amazing segue?
It's a great segue.
And I agree.
Here's the thing, though. Wait, let me tell you, you guys seriously elevate the conversation about, you know, people talk among themselves about movies and I liked it, I didn't like it. You guys really, and this is, I already got the gig, I'm here, folks. I don't have to try too hard. You elevate the conversation, though, you really
Thank
do.
You.
So you made me even think of something that I didn't realize involving Shemp Howard, one of my favorite Stooges, by the way. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Easy
sure.
to go Curly Moe Larry, and then it's like, well, who are you going to pick from the others? Shemp, he was great.
Totally.
Okay, and he played the bartender in the Black Pussycat Cafe. What he represents in this movie, because I realize he comes and goes a number of times, he's whistling the... Mm-hmm. He's whistling that throughout. He comes and goes like the motorcycle rider in Amarcord. Yeah, Fellini. Boom.
Whoa, look at that.
Do your homework, folks. If you watch Amarcord, there's a running sort of bit, a running piece of business with the motorcycle guy who rides through the town. Okay, Amarcord, Fellini. He's that guy.
Oh, look at that.
Shemp Howard. Shemp Howard comes and goes throughout this movie. And,
right on.
Yeah, so there you go.
So tell us why you love the bank.
Wait, can I ask a question?
That's the teacher in you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for that. Here's a question, and you can both answer at the same time or separately. Three Stooges, like them? Just, you know, like them or not like them?
They're okay.
Oh, how about this? Buy, rent, or...
I would rent the Three Stooges.
Okay,
rent.
Good.
Yeah,
now, Marco Brothers, I would revere.
All right.
Yeah.
Burn? Okay. Well, see, there you go.
I'll tell you. Some Three Stooges, though, definite buy.
Okay.
Niagara Falls?
Okay.
Unbelievably classic.
Good. Okay.
Am I right? Niagara Falls?
Yeah.
Niagara Falls!
Slowly I turn. Unbelievable.
I know. People say that line. Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, so buys and rents so far. Elvis Costello. Buy, rent,
burn. Elvis Costello.
I'm just throwing this out because you can help solve a...
Elvis Costello?
Elvis Costello, the musician and writer and...
Buy, you know, he's married to Diana Krall, so I gotta give him.
Here's why I'm gonna say burn. Because I saw Elvis Costello at Royal Albert Hall.
How many holes, by the way, does it take to fill that place? A lot, folks.
Six very big ones.
A lot.
Elvis Costello He left the show after 20 minutes because someone in the audience yelled out, "You're a wanker."
Oh, boy.
After 20 minutes, he left. Now, Curt Smith, that's
why did you do that?
Curt Smith from Tears for Fears is here. He would never do that.
Curt. Why did you do that?
Huh?
Why did you do that?
I just had to. Yeah. It just came to me.
Okay.
So,
Bank Dick.
Okay. Right. Now, you have an interesting story.
W.C. Fields was the third one. Buy Renter.
I would buy W.C. Fields.
Okay, good.
So you love that Bank Dick from 1940.
Mm-hmm.
Pourquoi?
Because it's funny, all right? Mm-hmm. And when I was asked, like, what are films that you like? I'm like, okay, Dr. Strangelove coming. And I go, no, this one sort of childhood memories because I would stay up until, remember broadcast TV? Remember when you could see anything anytime you wanted to? And you had to actually look at a TV guide and go, oh, this film that might be good or someone told me about is on at 2 in the morning on WGN Chicago. Back then that was where I lived.
Yeah.
Not on cable.
Yeah. Right.
WGN, where that was a station that we would watch on the subject.
It wasn't a super station, it was just a station.
It was not a super station.
Yeah.
Bozo the Circus in the afternoon, WC Field about 2 in the morning.
That's right.
So I think it has childhood's just sort of warm, nostalgic memories from that. Seriously, my parents would wake me up. Get the homework done, go to bed, brush the teeth, and go to bed. See what I mean?
Yeah.
And my parents would wake me up, they go, there's a WC Field's movie, Mark Spill's movie. I know like these guys, so we wake up, we watch, and it was pretty fun. So it has all that. Until it was, one of them was like, David Copperfield. And because in the TV guide, it would say W.C. Fields, he's in for like 2 minutes.
Yeah.
And then a bunch of boring dudes. You know, he's in it.
Somewhere. David Copperfield?
Yeah, he's, W.C. plays somebody in
there's a...
Do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's listed, because it's like, I don't know who's in this movie. I don't know these English actors. Yeah. So they put W.C. Fields, it's like, I'm going to wake up. It's like, he's not in the movie. He's in Bank Dick, and can't change it, Honest Man and all that.
He was in a silent film from 1915 called Pool Sharks, which I think is
terrific.
On YouTube. And in 1950, W.C. Fields was like 22 years old. He is thin, and he looks kind of like Steve Martin in a way.
Yeah, a little bit.
And it was... It was an interesting short film because not only because he was so young and he was so thin, but there was very rudimentary stop motion animation in the film because in the film it's about two pool sharks and they sort of try to do these trick shots to impress the girl. And you can tell like W.C. Fields will move his cue back and move it forward and then they'll cut to this miniature pool table where they do the stop motion animation, the balls going in and out of the pocket, you know, really rudimentary early stop motion. And I think it's on YouTube, Pool Sharks.
It's really good. If it's not YouTube, it's a different one of those video services, but it's
on
there.
Criterion. There's a Criterion disc of 6 W.C. Fields short films, and I know what's on that.
The Dentist, Fatal Glass of Beer, and those are other ones that show up in collections, so if you're looking for the collections, you can see it.
That's right.
Did you ever see my movie, Jumping the Pool Shark, where I didn't have any ideas, and then I just jumped the shark? American Graffiti. Not American Graffiti. Fonzie, where they jumped the shark.
Happy Days.
Producer Mike, Jump the Shark. Showbiz term, right?
There it is. Jump the Shark.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Okay, here's why you love Bank Dick. Because of the names of the characters.
Are you going to say them? Go ahead.
Well, the director, A. Pismo Clam.
Yes, A. Pismo Clam.
That is one of the names. Tell us about W.C. Fields' name in the movie.
His name in the movie is Egbert Saussay, right? The very first lines of the movie have to do with these two women are walking by his mailbox. And it's Sousse because it's accent grave over
and
the
E. And he always says it in the movie, goes, accent grave,
over
Sousse.
The E. Exactly. And it's fantastic. And the original screenplay is credited to Mahatma Kane Jeeves, right, which was W.C. Fields' name in this one, that he credited, who's the author of the Jeeves books?
That's actually interesting.
You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. That's interesting because I...
Jeeves, look it up, Mike.
Mark Skype and tweet it.
Jeeves. Who wrote Jeeves?
Jeeves Skype tweet. No, here's what I had heard. Right. I had heard he called it Mahatma Kane Jeeves because in his vaudeville show, we used to say, my hat, my cane, Jeeves.
Jeeves, right.
So he would say, my hat, my cane, so it became Mahatma Kane Jeeves.
Right. And that was because, what's his name?
Woodhouse.
Thank you. P.G. Woodhouse,
Martha's got it.
Well done.
P.G. Woodhouse, thank you.
Cut to the audience cam. Okay.
He was encouraged to read those books. He loved the P.G. Woodhouse Jeeves books or stories, okay? Yeah. So a way to sort of honor that was to use that in his vaudeville act and actually use that as his original screenplay line title.
Pretty sweet.
By the way, one more name before we move on.
Yeah.
J. Pinkerton Snoopington.
Right, exactly.
Awesome. Right?
Who's the bank owner?
Who's the bank owner? J. Exactly. Pinkerton Snoopington.
Oh, goodness. Ogoggleby.
Yeah. Ogoggleby.
Was the boyfriend of his daughter.
Yeah. Boyfriend of the daughter.
And his line was that it sounds like a bubble in a bathtub.
Yep.
Ogoggleby.
All right, well, we love the bank. We love the bank dick. It's a great, it's a great movie. Now, Mike, anybody commenting on the bank dick?
Elaine Ewing is.
Elaine? Whoa, Elaine Ewing!
Really?
Yeah.
Elaine, tell us why you love the bank dick.
Well, the bank dick for me, too, is the childhood memory. And me and my brothers, well, not just that one, but all of them. And there are certain things that even now, as adults, and now that my brothers all have kids, we do a hearty hand clasp.
Fantastic.
You know,
that's
from that the hard hand class.
That's a good one, isn't it?
And not from this one, but from Never Give a Sucker an Even Break. We do like Carl LaFong, capital L.
It's a gift.
Small,
It's a gift,
rather. Yeah. I'm sorry. So, so it's a childhood memory for me, too. But if you watch it now, I think what really bothers me is that nobody's calling in because you can't see this movie.
Right.
You can't see it, you know, on the internet. They don't play it on broadcast television anymore the way they used to. And I had a conversation recently with somebody about when I was a kid, every night they used to show The Honeymooners. Mm-hmm. And then they stopped. And now nobody knows The Honeymooners. So it's important, you know, that because, you know, a 12-year-old kid is not going to say, well, maybe there's a Criterion version. I think it's important that we show these. And W.C. Fields, if you like comedy now, you will like this. It's smart. This is a guy who had to get around the censors and came up with things like Godfrey Daniels, Mother of Pearl, and stuff like this, you know? Yep. So this is this
both of which are in the bank deck, by the way. He does them nice and loud.
Yes, and he juggles, and he's a fat guy that also can throw something in the air, kick it with his heel, and catch it in his hand.
Yeah.
I mean, he crosses over from vaudeville and brings things into talking movies that are driven by great dialogue. It isn't all slapstick. The bank dick, one of the best car chase scenes ever. People like car chases. What about the car chase in
amazing.
The bank dick? I feel like a whole generation has lost this.
Elaine, can I add to this that I like that you're watching it with your brothers, that it's kind of wall-to-wall stuff. If not jokes, at least clever things or weird business, funny business, right? That when you watch the Marx Brothers, and I love them too, what's always pretty trippy in there is you go, that Groucho is hilarious, and that Harper, so that's kind of a charming thing. Alan Jones is singing. And we love Alan Jones even, but it's like with the W.C. Fields movie, you don't know, there's none of that. Chekhov's not going to play the piano. It's like funny, movie's over. You had a good time.
Here's the genius of W.C. Fields to me. He was one of the first who figured out that punching a joke wasn't as funny as double punching a joke.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you set a joke up and then you punch it, people are laughing. They're not prepared now for another punchline. They're not prepared that the punchline is actually a setup for another punchline that's even funnier. And you're blindsiding the audience. And he does that time and time and time again. Right when you think you hit the really funny moment, he comes right back at you with something even funnier. And it's genius.
And the timing there, you were talking about some editing, it's clever editing in Inception too. Think about back then where they couldn't sweeten it, they couldn't add laughs because there weren't any, they were in the theater, right? And you had to just, here's my sense of timing, what if we held it this long? The $20 bill joke, right?
Incredible.
I read some piece about that and they were saying, hey, it wasn't his favorite joke when he saw it play. Then he was happy with it. He was like, well, "Let's do it. Let's, you know."
All right. So that's the bank dick. We all love the bank dick. You can get it on DVD. Now, Cinematic Titanic.
Yeah.
Now, I've seen Cinematic Titanic alive, right? It is absolutely hands down hilarious because A, it's hilarious for two reasons. A, because it's hilarious. Okay. And B, because it's based on Mystery Science Theater 3000, which is always hilarious.
Right.
Now,
and the formula for the Mystery Science, you know, I could talk about younger viewers who might not know what that is. You know, it's something where it's live movie riffing or live movie mocking, if you will, right? Mm-hmm. The Mystery Science thing worked. It was like, hey, bad movie, and they say funny things about it. Cinematic Titanic, there's no puppets or there's no robots involved, but it's the same people, right? Joel and Josh and Frank and Mary Jo and Trace. Same, the original cast of Mystery Science Theater, riffing on these movies. And they're dressed nicely.
And you guys are touring all around.
All around.
What's the next city?
The next city will be
Cinematic Titanic.
San Francisco, California. How about that?
Great.
What's up, San Francisco? What's up? What's up, 5'10"?
I think we're going to move on to Buy, Rent, or Burn. Gruber, you want to stay for Buy, Rent, or Burn? We're going
to
do the Buy, Rent, or Burn.
I would love to. I would be honored to do that.
There we go.
Okay, so you're sticking around. A, thank you, an early thank you, even though you're sticking around.
Oh, sure.
Now, Bank Dick is a great recommendation. Now, we have another recommendation for next week's Buy, Rent, or Burn. I know you think only I can recommend things because I'm Dave Allen Gruber, Gruber Allen
like
Dave.
It.
Not
you're
true.
You're doing a good impression of me.
Other people.
Look at that. Wow, that sounds exactly like me.
All right.
Is there a mirror? Wait a minute, there's a mirror here.
All right, so next week's Buy, Rent, or Burn is another celebrity Buy, Rent, or Burn.
Okay.
Now, Kristen Burt from The Web Files, who has been here before,
right.
in the audience, mm-hmm. as a guest. We love Kristen Burt.
Well,
she's got something.
She's here covering us.
Huh?
She was here doing a story on
I know. She did a very flattering story, and she's got a celebrity Buy, Rent, or Burn.
That sounds like a George Plimpton thing. She went in, Tom Wolfe, he's inside the thing, writing about
it. The story
you.
Continues, but we don't know it.
That's he, Hunter S.
Like
Thompson,
Inception.
Something.
So let's yeah, see. Exactly. So Kristen Burt is going to unveil her choice right now. Let's hear it.
Hi, Mark, Wade, and Mike. It's Kristen Burt from The Web Files. I'm so excited to join you guys for Stupid for Movies, Try This at Home. Now, I did tell Mike I'm a huge geek of this genre, and it's musicals. Now, I didn't want to get too nerdy, but I did go through my stash, West Side Story, too obvious, right? Chicago, we've all seen that one. Hairspray, too commercial. Moulin Rouge, been there, done that. My absolute favorite, though, is Funny Girl. Life's candy and the sun's boiled butter. All right, that's why I don't sing. And camp. I actually went to this musical theater camp. That's how big a geek I am. But this copy may have been brought in from another country. We won't tell anyone. But here's my selection. I want to go a little bit darker, a little bit edgier. It's a bit of Fosse. It's All That Jazz. That's right. I'll see you guys next week, July 22nd. So please join me. And don't forget to Skype in at home. See you next week.
Pretty cool.
Yeah, directed by Bob Fosse,
yeah.
starring...
Come on.
Huh?
I said, come on.
Starring Palme d'Or winner at Cannes.
Palme d'Or winner at Cannes, directed by Bob Fosse. Showtime, right? We all remember that. All right, so be here next Thursday at 8 p.m. Pacific time. You got a week to watch All That Jazz. You're going to love it. It's a great suggestion. It really is a great movie. It's a great movie.
I got a Bob Fosse story to join up with that.
Okay, no one cares. Okay. So, because right now, we want to get to Buy, Rent, or Burn!
Lightning round.
All right, so we got the show. All right, so we got Gruber's here for a Celebrity Buy, Rent, or Burn. Mm-hmm. Mike, fire away. Let's go. We got
all
Curt
right.
Smith from Tears for Fears waiting.
From these are all message board because people were complaining that we have not been visiting them. Here we go. Gizmo CH 8 Mile.
You know, I didn't mind 8 Mile.
I didn't either.
Okay.
Rent.
Well, it's because it's Curtis Hanson.
It's Curtis Hanson, and Eminem's really, really good in it. He's basically playing himself, but he's really good.
Rent it up.
Yep.
Gruber?
Every one of these, just to make it easier, I'm gonna say get it at the library. There we go.
and you know what? And take the bus to the library.
And
right?
take the bus to the library. You will have no footprint.
Right.
Ready? Go. Next
from
one.
Movie, no from footprint. Movie Revolt, Boy A.
I got it.
Ooh.
Library.
So completely buy.
We love that
so
movie. That's a great movie.
Completely buy. Unbelievable performances.
Yep. Buy it.
All right.
Boy A. Love it.
John Blund from Sweden asks about The Graduate.
I burned that. Come on, The Graduate.
Buy.
Nominated for
one word. One word. Plastics.
That's right. Nominated for Best Picture in the 1967. Okay, go. Buy it.
Let's go to Eckhart.
Aaron Eckhart?
We're going to skip
like
one. The Beat That My Heart Skipped.
Ooh, I like that movie.
Find it, then
rent.
Get because, it at the library.
Well, like, I feel
here's
like
the
a
thing.
Rent.
No, that. I would rent that, and I would rent that, and I would buy his next film, A Prophet.
Oh.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, that, what he said.
What
he's
I
saying
said.
Rent.
I'm saying rent,
shoot and, my and pro- a profit out this week on Blu-ray and DVD.
A great movie.
All right.
Buy that.
From Broby, Cinemania. 2002.
Well, take the bus to the library. Let's get a card saying, can we get a card saying take the bus to the library?
I got one for that one. YouTube clips of it. And then piece it together.
Download
part 15 of Cinemania somehow it comes together.
The Microsoft software from like 10 years ago?
I'd say rent that, sure.
Okay, sure.
From an aspiring oddity asks about Akira.
Oh, I like Akira.
I love Akira, but it's. I mean, you got to be an anime fan, right?
Yes. It will not convert anybody. It will not convert a non-believer or
yeah.
a
if you, I'm gonna, this is conditional. I'd say rent, unless you're an anime devotee.
Which
in which
you
case,
already
you,
own
gotta,
it.
You already own it. So bye.
All right. From Havertor, Lance Munagi's Six String Samurai.
You gotta rent that.
Oh,
cool.
Wade's got it.
It's cool.
It's, you know, I mean, it's a low-budget It's so low budget. The only, you know what, Rent, only because it's got the Red Elvises in it, who are kind of like a
cool... Oh, I love the Red Elvises.
Because they're kind of like a cool knockoff of the Leningrad Cowboys.
That is true.
How about this? How about Re-Gift It?
Re-Gift It?
No, I...
You know, like, somehow you'll get it because somebody gave it to somebody.
All right, we got two more. New Fate 26 asked about full-time killer.
Actually, for that, I would Secret Santa that one.
Secret Santa.
Don't take his bit. Don't steal Gruber's bit.
You know what? I know one of the screenwriters, so I'm...
Bye. The screenwriters.
Yeah.
Good for you, man.
If you ever want to make a movie, make sure you know Wade, apparently, because
right.
He'll love it. And one more. Let's go. Video Clerks, American Splendor.
Aww. Bye. Harvey Pekar just passed away.
You know, we gave that Best Picture in LAFCA. Were you in LAFCA when we
I was
best
not
picture?
In LAFCA when you gave American Splendor the
That was
best
the year
picture.
Before you got in, right?
That is true.
Yeah.
That is true.
I was in already at that time.
guys, come on.
Sorry.
Kurt's
Take
waiting.
Outside.
You guys, come on. Right. Keep it together right. for Kurt.
So
Stay together
is,
for Kurt.
Totally.
We'll do our best. There it is, folks. Bye, Rent to Burn. Yes! All right, so here we go. Now hang on for a second.
I was excited about where the show's going.
We're about to get rid of you,
okay.
Comedy icon,
yeah.
And replace you,
right.
Musical icon.
Gotcha.
Because here's the thing.
I can't wait. That's why I'm just excited. Why is he on my case, Wade? I was ready to make
because, one. Because I'll be honest.
Right, it's cool.
Stupid for Movies is the first show in the Streaming Garage. Yeah. But I'll have you know that we are not the only show in the Streaming Garage. There will soon be another show in the Streaming Garage that involves Curt Smith.
Nice.
Kurt Smith from Tears for Fears.
Nice.
Great solo work. He has a very special announcement. Let's take a look right now at some of Curt Smith's stuff. Not that you need reminding, but roll it. That video. Mm. What do you think? You're looking at that. It was so many years ago.
I'm thinking I was on a like a running machine on one bit, I think, and I'm pretending to walk because it's it's all green screen or blue screen as it was back then. I think. When did it change from blue to green? By the way,
it did it sometime in the 80s. Late 80s. Yeah.
So, you know, it's basically us with a guy, a director called Jim Blashfield, and he did everything after we left. So we kind of, you know, we just turned up to Portland, Oregon, and stood on a running machine, pretended to walk, sang a bit, and filmed against a plane backdrop, and that was it.
That song got me through mile four of a 5 mile run about a week ago. So
did
thank you.
Did you get to mile five?
I did. Okay. I did.
As long as you made it to
it
the end.
It was a tough mile four, okay. So thank okay. you.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
It's the reason it was written, I feel.
All right, now, Curt, there's a reason why you're here.
I think so. Yes.
Let's hope. You know what? Really, you're Curt Smith.
There's got to be some reason.
There doesn't have to be a reason because you're Curt Smith.
This is very exciting.
But there is a reason.
We're all working very hard at this and have established Stupid for Movies. And so this is a very exciting moment, I think, for me and for the whole crew and everybody who's worked really hard to get this going the last few months. And let Curt take it away.
Well, actually, starting next week, there's going to be a new show in the streaming garage, or garage, as we like to call it. there'll be a new accent as well, slightly more English. Won't involve movies, going to involve music. So, yes, next week we're going to start a show called Stripped Down Live. Here in the streaming garage, or garage. And it's going to be great. I mean, we're going to have an artist or band come in every week and play live in this very garage. And I'll be sitting in with them. I'll be interviewing them, talking to them. They'll play live. There's like no auto-tune, no nothing. It is what you get. It's going to be very rough and ready, but I think it'll really showcase these bands well. And I'm kind of looking forward to it. You know, being a host will be interesting. What do you think, producer Mike?
I'm very excited. I mean, because I'm
sure.
I'm pretty excited.
I mean,
because
I'm kind of trusting that you know what you're doing.
No, what we're doing is we're going to bring bands in, and our first band is called Hypnogaja.
Yes, that I know.
Which is a big band.
Whom I met at a Twitter conference.
Kurt met him at a Twitter conference. And we're going to bring them in. They're going to play, and we call it Stripped Down, so they're going to be playing acoustic, doing a bunch of their songs.
It's not going to involve me getting naked, though.
No.
It's not that.
Okay. No. Kurt will not be stripping down. Unless it gets us more hits, then we'll say, sure, why not?
Okay.
You can right now, you can actually go to our Twitter, at Stripped Live. Stripped Down, already taken by, you know, we don't want that kind of...
Yeah, I don't...
You'll see who's taken by, we don't need that. So at Stripped Live...
I'll be looking later to see who got Stripped Down.
At Stripped Live, you can also go down to Stripped Live, StrippedDownLive.com for more information. We're putting up a kind of a basic page at first right now. But Wednesday night, July 21st, 8 p.m., they're going to come in, they're going to play some songs, Kurt's going to interview...
Should I put that in my, like, diary?
Yeah, that might want to be...
I'm going to put that in my phone, was it, like, next Wednesday?
And we're going to bring in all different kinds of bands that Kurt loves, that people can suggest, and we're looking, I think, really good musicians to show off, you know, the musicianship and what they can do and how they can play, you know, their songs in a, like I said, a stripped-down, very rough, raw atmosphere.
Well, I mean, it really does showcase how good these musicians are, you know? I mean, it actually is hard to come into a studio... like this, like, very glamorous place that we're in right now, and actually carry it off and be able to perform and be believable. And so I think it's going to be kind of exciting for me anyway. You know, you actually discover, you know, the true kind of artist in these people when they can manage to do that instead of, you know, without the production, without the studio and everything else. So.
And then other than just playing, you know, it's you're going to be interviewing them. So
I'm
going
to be talking to them, yeah.
Musician to musician to find out very interesting.
I don't know about what yet, but,
no,
you know, probably music.
Yeah.
You know, although tonight I'm really on movie. Yeah, I might talk to them about movies.
That would be weird.
What's your favorite? Oh, we could get into a buy, was it buy, rent, or...
Buy, rent, or...
Trash.
Yeah, buy, rent, or steal from your friend.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Should we MP3 this? Should we steal it from LimeWire, or should we actually go
buy it? That's stupid for music. It's a whole other.
Yeah, exactly. That's another show.
So that's it. Yeah, that's the big announcement that we're very, very excited
about. Yeah! There it is.
I'm looking forward to it. So I will be here next Wednesday, July 21st, 8 o'clock.
Perfect. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So, like we have to convince you to watch Curt Smith on Stripped Down Live, right? You're going to watch it, because, right, it's Curt Smith, it's live bands.
My kids will be watching.
That's two. The longest journey begins with the smallest step. And he's got two. Fantastic. It's, the show sounds great, especially nowadays when music, it just feels so manufactured, and it's all machinery and electronics.
Well, it is, and then, you know, when you get to things like MTV, which actually doesn't actually have music on anymore. And there are no... I mean, for me, you know, when we were first discussing this and when I first met with producer Mike here about it, when I was growing up, we had the old Grey Whistle Test, which was this TV show in England. And it was just bands playing live, and this old guy, and I'll take the place of the old guy, you know, would sit there and like talk to them about music and about lyrics and about meanings behind songs and you know, and politics or anything, you know. And so it, for me, that was my sort of introduction into music when I was growing up, was it had a deeper meaning than just I'm standing up there looking good and playing music. So I'm hoping to bring that to this show. At least we can cross our fingers.
No, you will.
You will.
Because you have the insight, right? Because when you when you write music, the songs that you write come from somewhere. They mean something to you.
Yeah, I mean, I'd spend an inordinate amount of time writing lyrics. So, you know, it's kind of like, you know, the film version of script writing. You know, you need everything, but it has to fit into a certain space. So there's a certain talent and artistry to that. And, you know, I really would like to get more in depth with bands as to what the process is and the thinking is and everything else.
Because it's funny, because when you get people who don't know music talking to musicians, or people who don't know comedy talking to comics, they never really get into really fine-grained into what it takes, the inspiration and the sweat and where it comes from. But if you get a musician talking to musicians, it's a whole nother level.
Well, one would hope. Yeah, I mean, I did it like quite a while, like 15 years ago when I lived in New York. It was a radio show I did, which was the same kind of thing. Band would come into the studio, play live. And I mean, I found it very gratifying. And it was also interesting for me, you know, to see younger, especially younger, newer artists who are kind of inspiring to me still. You know, a lot of the time when you listen to the radio or watch TV or music on TV, it tends to be a little generic. My aim is to have no one generic.
Oh, that's awesome.
That is a great aim.
Excellent.
I have no doubt you guys are going to do it, because producer Mike's on the case.
I know.
Yeah, I love music, and I'm the same way. I like original music, and I like to hear it, actually. I want to hear, like, the acoustic chords where the song came from.
Yeah.
Strip away all the layers. I like four-track, you know. I like the old 60s mono stuff, so I'm very excited for the show.
All right, so here's the situation. You got to watch All That Jazz before next Thursday at 8 p.m. Pacific time. Dave, write this down.
ATJ.
Well done. And put it in the books Wednesday.
Wednesday, July 21st.
Next Wednesday, Stripped Down Live. 8 p.m.
Here from the streaming, stream in.
With the apostrophe N. Because otherwise
stream
it's
in.
Two G's. And
stream in garage. Garage.
Yes. Good luck with it. Curt Smith, everybody. All right, guys. Here's the show. Thank you, Curt. Thank you, Dave, Gruber, Alan, Wade. I'm not thanking you. You're here every week anyway. Thanks to the crew. Good night, everybody.
Good night.